If you're running both UA and GA4 on your website, and you go into both products to see how your site's performing, you're going to see some differences, which usually immediately leads people to think that one product is broken. Maybe they're both broken. But in reality, both products are measuring stuff the best they can, but they use the same words to mean slightly different things. Confusing? Yes, absolutely. If you Google the differences between UA and GA4, you're going to get a very boring list of metrics courtesy of Google. A lot of it's pretty technical as well, especially if you aren't familiar with the ins and outs of GA4 already. In fact, a lot of the information in this article about UA also won't make sense unless you have a lot of experience using that tool as well. Most people just want to set up their analytics and then look at some basic information about how their website's performing. That is not the audience for this Google Help article. This video, on the other hand, will help you understand the differences between UA and GA4 from a normal human being perspective. First, I want to clarify some terminology I'm going to use in this video: dimensions and metrics. If you aren't familiar with those terms in an analytics context, a dimension is a grouping of data, for example, a specific page or a channel that brought people to your website, like Facebook, for example. A metric is a number, the number of times that page was viewed, or the number of people who came to your site via Facebook. Also, if you would like to visually see the differences between your UA and GA4 data, Chris Hasidon has published an excellent Looker Studio dashboard that you can use to compare your two properties. We have a link to access that report in the resources. Let's start with the user's metric. This is the number of people who came to your website, right? Unfortunately, UA and GA4 measure this differently, of course, which is why the numbers probably aren't going to match. A user, as far as Google Analytics is concerned, generally is a device. So if I'm on my phone and I'm on my laptop, I'm two users. There are some ways to combine those two devices and know that I'm the same person on both, but the simplest answer is that every device is a user. UA counted everyone as a user, period. Which meant you ended up with weird situations, like when you have 50 tabs open and reactivated your browser after your laptop went to sleep. Each of those little browser tabs would send a little "you still there?" message to the website, and then UA would dutifully record that check-in as a user with a 0-second page view, even though you didn't look at the tab. In GA4, they've tried to get rid of this issue, so when you see users in GA4, what they're counting are active users. Those are people who are what's called engaged, which is also a new metric in GA4. Active users are those people visiting your website for the first time or spending at least 10 seconds with your website as their active tab or going to a second page or converting. If 10 seconds seems a little short, you can adjust that in the settings. I prefer the GA4 metric because it focuses on actual people using your website as opposed to all those potential tab hoarders. We've seen differences of anywhere from 5 to 30% between UA and GA4 when it comes to user counts. Related to users, let's talk about sessions. Sessions are pretty different in GA4 compared to UA, and that's because of how GA4 records things that happen on your website. UA considers a session to be a collection of stuff that you did while visiting your website. There's a few ways a session would end: 30 minutes of inactivity, or whatever you had your session timeout set as. Most people never change the default setting, so in your case it was probably 30 minutes. Or a person could hit midnight in your UA time zone setting, which would end their current session and start a new one. Or if they came back to the website through a different source. For example, let's say you visited a website via a Google ad, and then you couldn't find what you were looking for, so then you went back out to Google, and you Googled the name of the company plus what you were looking for, then you clicked on a non-paid organic search result to get back to the website. That would end the previous paid session and start a new organic session. Now, in GA4, when you first arrive on the website, GA4 records an event called Session Start and creates a session ID for you. Then every piece of data sent off to GA4 includes that session ID. The 30-minute timeout, or whatever you set it to, that still applies, but sessions aren't cut off at midnight anymore, and they don't end if someone comes back via a different marketing channel, if their current session is still active. Well, why would these metrics vary? Could be filters in your UA, could be geography if you have a lot of people hitting that midnight limit on a regular basis, but what the difference is probably is that GA4 estimates session counts. They don't actually count the number of unique session IDs that were generated for that particular GA4 property. It does an estimate instead of an actual count because they probably don't want to spend a lot of processing time on counting the number of sessions. Basically, Google wants to save money. You could always export the data from GA4 and do your own counts, but in most cases, know that it will vary, and that's why. When comparing UA to GA4, you might see differences in the 10% to 30% range when it comes to sessions. Before we move on from users and sessions, I'd also like to discuss acquisition data. That's the "how did people get to my website" information. In UA, you'd see that information under acquisition, and you see information for users, new users, and sessions all in a single report. In GA4, acquisition is entirely split up between users and sessions. So what should you use in your reporting? That depends on what you're measuring. If you have people logging into your website and you're sending user IDs off to GA4, you'd know if you were doing this, then you want to look at the user reports. Otherwise, the session reports are going to be what you want most of the time. Users just isn't a reliable way to count people visiting your website unless you can track them using your own logins. So these two options, user acquisition and traffic acquisition, have the same limits on measurement we just covered. No analytics product is 100% accurate at all times, ever. Also, remember that a ton of people use ad blockers, they use browsers that clear their cookies regularly, and they use other identity obscuring products that prevent you from tracking acquisition clearly. You definitely are never seeing the full picture here, no matter what analytics tool you use. There are also some new channel dimensions in GA4 that are definitely worth a mention. In fact, you might start seeing some right away in your reports, depending upon what kind of traffic you already have coming to your website. There's a full list here on Google site, but the new ones include things like audio, mobile push, and SMS. Social media is now split into organic social versus paid social, and there's new paid shopping and paid video channels as well. And you might have seen a channel called Other in UA. That's now called Unassigned in GA4, and that's traffic that has a source and medium combination that doesn't match GA4's default channel definitions. You can add two custom channels as well for traffic sources that don't match up nicely with GA4's channel groupings, but overall it's a big improvement from UA. The next metric that's commonly used is page views. This metric is usually pretty close. What typically makes a difference is if you had filters set up in your UA that might have been excluding people based on your office locations, maybe a development website, that sort of thing. In GA4, this metric is called views. UA also had a metric called unique page views, which was just that, total number of pages viewed but no duplicates. So if someone went to your homepage twice during a session, the page view count would be one. That metric does not exist in GA4, so if you were using it for reporting, time to switch. Conversions, of course, are really important. That's how you know if your marketing work is paying off, right? There are some pretty big differences in how conversions work between UA and GA4. In UA, conversions were called goals, and you define them based on a few options. A goal could be based on an event you recorded when a conversion happened, like someone filling out a form or calling you. It could have been based on when a specific page was viewed, like a thank you page. You could even have a conversion based on the number of page views or how long someone spent on the website. Now, if you had those types of conversions were bad, and you should not have them any longer. We have a pretty firm rule at Kickpoint when it comes to conversions. If that action is directly contributing to your business organizational goals, then it can count as a conversion. Otherwise, it's just an interesting observation. So if, say, you had ads on your site and you made money via people viewing pages, then maybe the number of pages that people viewed mattered, but most of the time, that isn't the case. In GA4, conversions are based entirely on events, because GA4 is based entirely on events. But there are ways to recreate the things you used to track before as events. The most important thing to know about conversions in GA4 is that there is an option to change how the conversion is counted, and that's important for when you're comparing conversions between UA and GA4. In UA, a specific conversion, a goal, would only be counted once per session. So if you were on a website and filled out a form three times, you would only have one conversion. This was pretty common for things like B2B companies putting resource downloads behind a form. You might download more than one thing in your session, but if that company was grouping all downloads under a single goal, which they would typically do, they'd only see one conversion for that session. In GA4, you now have the choice in how you want your conversions to be counted. They can be counted every time it happens, that's called once per event, or you can change it to count the UA way, which is called once per session. Make sure to check all of your conversions, especially if they were imported from UA, because they might be sent to once per session, and maybe that doesn't make sense anymore. Related to goals, let's talk about purchases briefly. These should match up more or less between UA and GA4, and that's one metric that GA4 is not really messing around with. So if you have an e-commerce website and you're seeing big discrepancies between the revenue recorded in UA and GA4, you probably have a configuration issue going on that you need to take a look at. Now, last and frankly, certainly least, let's talk about bounce rate. I hate bounce rate. It is the most useless metric because it was not measuring what anyone thought it was actually measuring. In UA, bounce rate was measuring the amount of sessions where only one page was visited and no measured interactions occurred. This was flawed because let's say, for example, you have a newsletter form on your blog post. Someone could have spent 20 minutes reading your blog post, signed up for your newsletter, but because you didn't take them to another page to say thank you when they signed up, which is a nice thing to do from a user experience perspective, it doesn't matter. You weren't recording scroll depths, you weren't recording if that form was filled. That person now counts as a bounce. That's incorrect. And that's why bounce rate sucks. Now in GA4, there is a new metric called engaged sessions, and we all thought bounce rate was dead, great, let's look at engaged sessions. But it isn't. GA4 decided to introduce a metric called bounce rate, but it's not measuring the same thing. In GA4, bounce rate is the percentage of sessions that weren't engaged sessions. So what's an engaged session? Remember earlier when I talked about active users, those were visitors who were going to your website for the first time, are spending at least 10 seconds with your website as their active tab, or going to a second page, or converting. And if 10 seconds is too short, you can make that longer in your GA admin settings. But that isn't at all what bounce rate was measuring in UA. And as I said, I do like engaged sessions. I think it's a really useful metric, but it isn't going to match your bounce rate in UA at all. If it does, it's a total fluke and not on purpose. So while I hope you weren't reporting on bounce rate to your boss or client for all these years, you probably were. If you were, you're going to have to explain why that metric is going away and why engagement rate is more effective. And with that, those are the major differences in how certain things are measured between UA and GA4. Now, you should be able to explain why the data looks different, and if it's too different, you know where to start troubleshooting. Do you still have more questions? Check out our other videos to get more answers, and leave a comment letting us know what topics you want us to cover in future videos. Thanks so much for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe.